I'm hoping today that I'm going to be speaking to the choir. Now, do you know what I mean by that? I hope you agree or already agree to what I'm going to say, because what I've got to say is not new to you. To some out there who may be listening by internet, some of these ideas may be a little, just a touch different, but they're biblical, and I challenge you to look up the texts that I mentioned this morning. Before we start, let us bow our heads. Father, we're grateful that we have your word to guide us. It's not man's word. It's not man's tradition, but it's your word inspired throughout. So as we look at these texts this morning, as we share what you would have us to know, bless us, may your spirit lead us, in Jesus' name, amen. You know, from time to time, it's imperative for us to review what we're going to talk about. And this is especially true with young people. You know, we are living in a very dangerous time. We are bombarded, if we could have a little less volume here, we are bombarded by an invasion of media, especially, that exposes us to increasingly subtle manifestations of the devil's handiwork. Can you say amen to that? This often involves communication with the dead. Often. And often we don't even recognize it as such. That's how pervasive it has become. Communication with the dead and or the deification of the dead are dangerous, unholy. In fact, the Bible calls it an abomination, a hateful act, a detestable act. Communication with the dead and or deification of the dead are dangerous, unholy activities and should be avoided at all costs. These phenomena, that is, this communication with the dead, these phenomena are rampant today, both inside and outside the Christian world. I'm sad to say it's rampant in much of the Christian world. This channeling that we're exposed to in a secular vein, TV shows, apparitions, seances, spiritualism, veneration of saints, yes, veneration of saints, continual exposure can lead to a gradual acceptance, imperceptibly, a gradual acceptance, leading one to erroneous conclusions. You know, if you see something often enough, what happens? You begin to believe it. And this is true in this area. Satan is preparing this world. And he's preparing it for his final delusions. Satan's ultimate deception, of course, is going to be the personification of Christ. Of Christ. Before we get further in, I want to give you a few definitions. We already talked about abomination. The Bible talks about abominations. Well, abomination, as I said, is a detestable, hateful act. Detestable, hateful act. It's something that God detests. Now, the following definitions are all going to involve, one way or the other, evil spirits. What did I say was going to involve? Evil spirits. And these evil spirits, brothers and sisters, are real. I'm going to take them not in any particular order. Witchcraft. Witchcraft is the art or practices of a witch, sorcery, or magic. Now, there's probably, you could expand on that. A sorcerer is a magician or a chanter. One supposed to exercise supernatural powers through evil spirits. This is a sorcerer. A medium. Now, there's a term which we hear a lot. A medium is a person serving or conceived as serving as an instrument for the manifestation of another personality. It's a medium, not only of another personality or of some alleged supernatural agency. This is a medium. We're talking about dangerous things today. We're talking about things that could end up destroying you. Necromancy. Now, that's a word that's only pretty much found in the Bible. I haven't seen it too many other places. Necromancy is magic, an enchantment, it's communication with the dead. Communication with the dead. Soothsayer is one who professes to foretell events. You may hear the crystal ball, palm reading, tea leaves, etc. Soothsayer. He may not use anything. The question is, what does God have to say about all of this? He lays us a foundation when he tells us a key thing that we all should know and agree on. What happens to a person when he or she dies? Misinformation on this, and I say misinformation on this, is something which is not biblical, based mainly on Greek thought, which has crept its way in even into the church. I'm hoping not the Adventist church, but churches. Misinformation on what happens to a person when he dies or she dies. But listen to what God has to say. And shouldn't God know what happens to somebody when he or she dies? After all, God created the first beings. What did he say when he created Adam and Eve? The Bible says he created Adam. He created matter. He formed them from the dust of the ground. Isn't that right? In Genesis? And he breathed into his nostrils what? The breath of life, which is his spirit. So there are two things which make up a person or a soul. It's the body and the breath of God. Now, death is simply the separation of the two things. As a consequence, the soul disappears. It doesn't go anywhere. It just ceases to exist. Ecclesiastes 9, verses 5 and 6. Ecclesiastes 9. And by the way, you don't have to take notes because I've given an outline to this that will be passed out at the end of the service. Ecclesiastes 9. In fact, if there are those who are watching by internet and would like to receive a copy, I'm sure they would make that available here at the Plainville Seventh-day Adventist Church. Just call or go on their email. It says, "For the living know that they will die." Do you know that you will die?
Absolutely.
Of course. "But the dead know nothing." How much do the dead know?
Nothing.
Nothing. Is that clear? Is there something that's interpretive there? Is there something we have to really grapple with? The Bible says the dead know nothing. "And they have no more reward, as a matter of fact, for the memory of them is forgotten. Also their love, their hatred, and their envy have now perished." The Bible says, "Never more will they have any share in anything done under the sun." So when someone claims that they saw their mother or grandmother standing at the foot of their bed, one thing you can be sure of, it wasn't the grandmother or the mother, because the Bible says they will have nothing to do with anything under the sun. Their thoughts perish.
Jesus was exempt. He rose.
Jesus rose is the only one. Well, we have examples of other people who are raised up, but you're right, Jesus rose. But most of us will die and stay dead. Psalm 146 and verse 4 talks about when a person dies. It says his spirit departs. That's not his soul, but his spirit, that which God breathed into him. He returns to the earth. In that very day, his plans, other versions say his thoughts, perish. Folks, when we die, we're dead. We don't go anywhere. They may put our body in the ground. We may be cremated, but we don't go up, down, or sideways. We cease as persons to exist. Praise God that, as the gentleman said, Jesus rose, that we may have a chance of also raising, being raised up in the last days. So we're thankful for that. But it's important to remember, the Bible says that when we die, we die. We cease to exist. We don't go anywhere. We don't come back to visit relatives. We don't stand at the bottom of beds. We don't float in the air. We're dead. Period. So, the question arises, what is all this, what are all the phenomena that you hear about? You hear about people seeing grandmothers or mothers or wives or what have you. I'm going to show you from the Bible that these spirits, and they're real, are evil spirits. How did this happen? Revelation chapter 12 and verse 7. The Bible says in Revelation 12:7, "And war broke out in heaven, Michael, another name for Jesus, and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought. There was a real war. But they, that is the devil and his angels, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. This is where the rub comes. So that great dragon, referring to Satan, was cast out, that old serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. Listen to this, end of the verse. It says, he was cast to the earth. Where was he cast? To the earth. But that's not all. And his angels were cast out with him. Brothers and sisters, we're going to show that these angels are the spirits, so-called, that people see. They may masquerade as real folks. They may pass themselves off as grandma or grandpa or whatever. But these are evil spirits. You say, how could they do this? Well, don't you think they knew grandma and grandpa? Don't you think they can masquerade as grandma and grandpa? Look what you see on the media today. All the stuff that isn't real that you think is real. It's unbelievable. In fact, not the same, but in the same vein, the Bible in Hebrews chapter 1 calls good angels. You know what he calls good angels? He calls them ministering spirits. Well, these are not ministering spirits, these evil ones. These are evil spirits. 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1. And now the Spirit, that is the Holy Spirit, expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and the doctrines of demons. Brothers and sisters, to fool with evil spirits is dangerous business, because they are full of the doctrine of demons. They are deceiving. They do not have your good intentions in mind. These are evil spirits. In fact, right near the end of time, when the seven last plagues fall upon the earth, God's last expression of his displeasure, the sixth plague contains the following. Revelation 16, and we'll read verses 13 and 14. And I saw, quoting John the Revelator, and I saw three unclean spirits, like frogs, coming out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. Now, what are they? Verse 14. They are the spirits of demons. What do they do? Performing signs which go out to the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. Folks, these are real things. These are not figments of our imagination. Evil spirits are real. Do you believe me this morning when I say that? Yes. Evil spirits are real. They're real. So, do we have any counsel from God on how to treat or deal with these evil spirits? Remember now, When we were giving the definitions, we said, we mentioned the word medium, and we mentioned the word sorcerer, we mentioned the word soothsayer, all these dealing with evil spirits. Well, what does God have to say about this? Deuteronomy, chapter 18, 9 to 12. God is speaking to his people before they enter into the promised land. He's speaking to them, but the words are relevant. He says, when you come in to the land which the Lord your God is giving you, you shall not learn to follow the abominations. Now, there's that word again, the detestable act or hateful acts. You will not learn to follow, or you shall not learn to follow the abominations of these nations. Now, listen to what was included in this. There shall not be found among you anyone who makes his son, this is Father's Day, his daughter, or tomorrow's Father's Day, his son or his daughter pass through the fire. Now, would you consider that to be an abomination? I would. Would you consider that to be a hateful act? I would. But this is what was happening among the people whose land the Israelites were about to occupy. Or one who practices witchcraft. So he links the abomination of this experience with the kids passing them through the fire with witchcraft. Or a soothsayer. Or one who interprets omens. Or a sorcerer. Or one who conjures spells. Or a medium. Or a spiritist. Or one who calls up the dead. God is telling us, don't bother with this. Stay away from this. These are abominations. For all who do these things, the Bible says in verse 12, for all who do these things are an abomination to the Lord. They're not cute. They're not for your entertainment. It's an abomination to the Lord. Amen. And because of these abominations, the Lord your God drives them out before you. I would say that's a serious indictment. What do you say? Amen. I'd say that's a serious indictment. We could turn to many places in the scripture, but I'll turn to another couple here, just a couple. Leviticus chapter 19, verse 31. The Bible says, God says, give no heed or no regard to mediums or familiar spirits. How much regard should we give? None. Do not seek after them. So if someone says, hey, we're having a seance over at so-and-so's house. Are you going? I hope not. Where was I here? I was at verse 31. Give no regard to mediums or familiar spirits. Do not go after them to be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. Is there any doubt how God feels about this?
No.
Right across the page here, Leviticus chapter 20 and verse 6, the Bible says, and the person who turns after mediums and familiar spirits to prostitute himself with them I will set my face against that person and cut him off from his people. I would say, folks, that these are fairly strong words. I would say that God is not pleased with this kind of activity. Again, it's not cute. It can kill you. Now, how you may say, well, I would never do that. But if you're like the average person, instead of staying as far away from trouble as you can, sometimes human nature says, I'm going to dabble just a little bit, just to check it out. Well, what does God have to say about that? Psalm 106. Talking about the people of Israel, about what they did not do and what they did do. God is speaking. He said in verse 34 of Psalm 106, when the people of Israel came into the land, it says they did not destroy the peoples concerning whom the Lord had commanded them. Verse 35 is the danger point. Now listen carefully. What does it say? But they mingled. They mingled. They dabbled with the Gentiles and learned of their works. They served their idols, which became a snare to them. Verse 37 says, they even sacrificed their sons. This is talking about the children of God. They even sacrificed their sons and their daughters to demons. And they shed innocent blood. Even the blood of their sons and daughters, whom they sacrificed to the idols of Canaan. And the land was polluted with their blood. And they were defiled by their own works and played the harlot by their own deeds. Brothers and sisters, folks out there in listening by internet, we are not to mingle with this stuff. We are not supposed to dabble with this stuff. We are supposed to avoid this. It's a matter of life and death. God says in Isaiah 8, 19 and 20, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is how much? There's no light in them. Or you might say, Herm, this is the 21st century. Has God changed his mind? Does God change his mind on these things? Last book of the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 3. In the beginning part of verse 6, God tells us what he's all about. He says, for I am the Lord. What's the next words? I do not change. What God told the people back a long time ago, he's telling us today. Don't fool with this stuff. It is evil. It is hateful. It is detestable. And we've become so immune because of exposure, we don't even think about these things anymore, my guess. This is a wake-up call today. Isaiah chapter 42, verses 8 and 9. God kind of summarizes his thoughts here. He says, I am the Lord. That is my name. Is there any wonder, by the way, this is just an insertion, a parenthetical insertion. Is there any wonder why God is being written out of our life by the secular media? Is there any wonder? I wonder who's in back of it. Who do you think? Who is in back of the attempt to take God out of the equation? Murray, you're right. It's Satan. He, destroying the true Sabbath, he has denigrated God from being creator, sustainer, provider, and yes, the giver of good counsel. He says, I am the Lord, verse 8. This is my name, and my glory I will not give to another, nor my praise to graven images. For behold, now listen, behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I declare. Not mediums, not soothsayers, not in seances do you find out new things. God says, I declare these new things. New things I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. Boy, God is very clear on where we should be getting our information. God hasn't changed his mind. An abomination to him is still an abomination to him. Folks, evil spirits are real. They are smarter than you. They are more powerful than you. Do not tamper or experiment with anything remotely connected with spiritualism. Ouija boards are not cute. They're dangerous. Do not be fooled by those claiming to have connections with God, but who do not measure up to Isaiah 8:20. Be able to answer for yourself based on God's word, not my word, God's word. What happens to a person when he dies? That should be rudimentary for us. The day will come when we won't be able to trust our eyes or our ears. We thought we've seen deception. My goodness, there is deception coming, folks. I want to read something. Do I have time to read something? I want to read something out of the book Patriarchs and Prophets. It's a chapter, part of a chapter, entitled Ancient and Modern Sorcery. I'm going to go start on page 684. I'm quoting. It says, nearly all forms of ancient sorcery and witchcraft were founded upon a belief in communion with the dead. Those who practiced the arts of necromancy claimed to have intercourse with departed spirits and to obtain through them a knowledge of future events. This custom of consulting the dead is referred to in the prophet, in the prophecy of Isaiah, and we read those words. The same belief in communion with the dead formed the cornerstone of heathen idolatry. The gods of the heathen were believed to be deified spirits of departed heroes. Thus, the religion of the heathen was a worship of the dead. The deification of the dead has held a prominent place in nearly every system of heathenism, as has also the supposed communication with the dead. The gods were believed to communicate to men, and also when consulted to give them counsel. And what does God call this? Begins with A. It's an abomination. It's an abomination. Of this character were the famous oracles of Greece and Rome. The belief in communication with the dead is still held. Now, this is written over 100 years ago. Even in professed Christian lands, under the name of spiritualism, the practice of communicating with beings claiming to be the spirits of the departed has become widespread. It is calculated to take hold of the sympathies of those who have had their loved ones in the grave, who have laid their loved ones in the grave. Spiritual beings sometimes appear to persons in the forms of deceased friends and relate incidents connected with their lives and perform acts which they performed while living. In this way, they lead men to believe that their dead friends are angels hovering over them, communicating with them. Those who thus assume to be the spirits of the departed, listen to this, are regarded with a certain idolatry. And with many, their word, that is the departed one's word, so-called, has greater weight than the word of God. There are many, however, who regard spiritualism as a mere imposture. In other words, it's phony. The manifestations by which it supports its claim to a supernatural character are attributed to fraud on the part of the medium. But while it is true that the results of trickery have often been palmed off as genuine manifestations, there have also been marked evidences of supernatural power. And many who reject spiritualism as a result of human skill or cunning will, when confronted with manifestations which they cannot account for upon this ground, will be led to acknowledge its claims. Modern spiritualism and the forms of ancient witchcraft and idol worship, all having communication with the dead as the vital example, founded on the first lie which Satan told Adam and Eve, Eve in the garden. What did he say? You shall not surely die. How has that expanded? How is that manifested today? Brothers and sisters, my prayer today for you is that you be grounded on God's word. Amen. That you will be sure in your mind and in your hearts. What happens when a person dies? You'll be sure about this, that nothing will take you away from that truth. That if perchance, and it could happen to any of us, that we run into an evil spirit, and we could. My grandmother could come and stand at the foot of my bed, or someone looking like my grandmother. Boy, that is an overwhelmingly convicting, can be, an experience. I pray that that is our experience, any of us. We will realize that it's not who he or she says he is, but it's an evil spirit. God bless you as you allow God to lead in your lives.
Amen.